or at TV, the world is thinking.
My name is Bill Kelly. I'm the president of the Graduate Center, and it's a joy to welcome you this evening. We're thrilled to have Patti Smith with us.
Hello.
Two months ago, the Museum of the City of New York, to celebrate the 400th anniversary of Henry Hudson's arrival in New York Harbor, published a list of the 400 most influential New Yorkers across this 400-year span, and there were three Smiths on the list. Al Smith, the governor who was responsible for the Empire State Building. James McCune Smith, a 19th century abolitionist and apothecary. And Patti Smith. We salute our friends at the Museum of City of New York. In 2007, Patti was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in a class that included R.E.M. and Grandmaster Flash, and my perpetual heartthrob, Ronnie Spector, the Ronettes. A couple of years before that, she was named by Rolling Stone magazine as one of the 100 greatest artists of the rock era, and they have them numbered. She was 47 between Janis Joplin and Run DMC. 2005, the French Ministry of Culture awarded her a Commandeur d'Art et Lettres, the highest award that the French ministry gives to artists and writers. Then major retrospects of her work, of her visual art mounted by the Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh, of her photography by the Fondation Cartier in Paris. Given the canonization of Patti Smith, it's a temptation.
Excuse me.
Yes, ma'am.
You forgot that I was Spartan of the Year in high school.
Spartan of the Year in high school. I believe she was awarded the tartan vest at that time to be the tartan Spartan in our presence. An honorary degree, I believe, as well from Glassboro, where you passed through for some time. I mean, given all of this, it's a temptation to think of Patti as a living landmark.
Or a big con artist.
One or the other. A kind of link to, on one hand, the Beats, to another, to Dylan and that folk rock scene, to the extraordinary explosion of interest in art, the redefinition of contemporary art in New York in the 1970s, of the punk movement and its after effects. In other words, the title, I think, of the Warhol show was Strange Messenger, and there's a temptation to think of Patti in those terms. But that misses the point, I think. I think most of us who have followed Patti's career would argue that the last 5 or 6 years have been among the most productive of her life as a musician, a writer, a filmmaker, extraordinary new film, Dream of Life, of a curator of the Meltdown Festival in London, a social activist. These have been remarkable. It's a remarkable present. So I think what we're going to try to do tonight with Patti's help is to thread together the past, the souvenir, the memory, with the extraordinary present that Patti's work speaks to. So with Patti's help, we're going to try to double up. Before I do that, I want to say thank you to Stephen Sebring and Edward Mapplethorpe for the loan and permission to use the photos you saw earlier, and particular thanks to the Studley Foundation, to the Leopold R. Gellert Family Trust, the Vital Projects Fund, and the Winston Foundation, who underwrite our public programs. We're very grateful to them. Patti, let me open with a quote from Complete, an extraordinary volume that collects your lyrics and a good deal of other things, 1975 to 2006. You say this. I say I got to put on my glasses first. These things were in my mind, speaking of 1975. The course of the artist, the course of freedom redefined. Thank you very much. I saw a photo of Patti wearing these glasses in between this week's Rolling Stone, in between Springsteen and Bono. So I feel particularly
They are the historic
privileged.
Glasses.
They are the historic glasses. I could tell. Where were we? The course of the artist, the course of freedom redefined, the recreation of space, the emergence of new voices. And I want to begin, if you will, with the course of the artist, more particularly your course. Born in Chicago, family moves to Philly, rural Jersey, working in a toy factory, which you memorialize in that extraordinary song, Piss Factory. Spent a little bit of time at Glassboro, come to New York in 1967. And you describe it as wandering through the debris of the 60s. What a great phrase. What brought you to New York? What drew you? What did you find when you got here?
Well, the practical thing that brought me to New York was there was no work in South Jersey or even Philadelphia for a 20-year-old girl with no skills. And so I thought I would have better luck in New York City. But also, living in a very rural area of South Jersey where everything you did was scrutinized and judged. And I've just been, I was just a natural person. I was the way I was. I wasn't trying to offend anybody, but it seemed like everything I did offended somebody. The way my hair was, that I didn't comb my hair, that I, how I dressed or if I wore black. I was reading books by French poets. Everything I did seemed to offend someone. So I would get a bus to New York periodically. And one thing I noticed in New York from 64 on was nobody cared. It wasn't a cruel kind of non-caring. It was, nobody was looking at how I, nobody seemed to mind how I was dressed or, if I had my hair in pigtails or, so I felt very free and very safe in New York City. So I really came just to, just like Dick Whittington. For me, the streets of New York were paved in gold, and I came, and I got a job. I got a job in a bookstore, and I met one of the great loves and friends in my life, Robert Mapplethorpe, and I loved it, and I especially loved the Empire State Building. So I'm really happy to know that a Smith had something
Absolutely.
To do with it.
Absolutely. You started shortly after you arrived to pursue drawing and painting, and yet you've talked about being frustrated with that process, with the challenge of standing between a paper tacked to a wall and trying to produce what you wanted to produce. Could you talk about those early efforts to define yourself as a visual artist?
I think what I was more I wasn't so frustrated with, what I was frustrated was I wanted to write, and then in writing, I felt a lack of physicality in writing. So I started writing on large sheets of paper, writing poems or doing sort of Twombly-esque kind of things, though I didn't know anything about Twombly then. And then I found that even that act was not physical enough, and I started speaking my poems and things out loud as I was writing and drawing. And Robert Mapplethorpe, who I was living with at the time near Pratt, always used to tell me, well, why don't you perform your poems and things, but it had never occurred to me. And it took me a long time to accept performance as an art form, because I was so fixated on writing and painting, and so I had never really thought about performance. But it must have been brewing in me, because
the famous night, was it February 10th, 1971, when you're opening for Malanga at the St. Mark's Poetry Project, and you decide not simply to read, but to perform, and you bring Lenny Kaye along. Could you talk a little bit about that evening? And because it, for a lot of people, is a watershed in...
Well, I mean, it wouldn't seem like life. A big deal now. You know,
no, of course.
But yeah. In 1971, you know, it was Bertolt Brecht's birthday, and it was my first time doing a poetry reading, and I'd been to a lot of poetry readings, and most of them were pretty boring. Yeah. And I didn't want to be boring. You know, I wanted to infuse some blood in what I was doing, and I had really good mentors. I mean, I was friends with Allen Ginsberg and Gregory Corso and these fellas, and none of them were boring. And so I had a challenge, you know. So I decided to ask Lenny Kaye to interpret a poem I had written about a boy in a stock car who crashes at the end on electric guitar, and I thought that would be cool. But back then it was like blasphemy because they never had electric guitar in St. Mark's Church. Lenny Kaye's electric guitar, I think, was pretty much, I know it was the first time anybody had done that. And for me, it was just a natural thing. You know, it was like, oh, that would be cool. I wasn't really trying to, you know, do anything, you know, controversial or blasphemous. I just wanted to connect with the people in a really strong way. And I guess we did.
Well, you said at one point about that performance, it seemed to have a negative effect. I took that as a positive sign.
Yeah.
that's a great line. I mean, you continue to play with Lenny and you bring others into Richard Soule and J.D. Daughtry and into the group. CBGB's opens Richard Hell and Tom Verlaine, television, all of those folks. And the thing that I'm interested in is how do you make that transition from the poet to the rock and roll star? I mean, there are precedents with the Beats, obviously, with people reading their poetry to music, but nothing like that kind of amplified juice that you guys brought into play at CBGB's.
Well,
What was that scene like? What were you guys?
I think that I was lucky. I mean, you know, I had examples like Jim Morrison, Jimi Hendrix, Bob Dylan.
Yeah.
There was a bar, you know, and because Jim Morrison was a true poet, and he. You know, infused rock and roll with real poetry.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't like it was anything new. It's just, and for me, it was an organic thing. I didn't plan anything. Yeah. It's just, I got bored when I was just reading.
Yeah.
And so I liked to perform. I like direct communication. And I love rock and roll, so I'd have never planned it, because never in my life. I mean, coming from rural South Jersey, first of all, when I went to high school, girls took home economics. The boys learned to drive. There was, you know, I graduated in 1964, and girls were, you had to get ready to be a wife, a mother, a hairdresser. And there's nothing wrong with any of those things. It's just I didn't gravitate toward them, and although I am a proud mom, but I just the idea of a girl having, you know, being the leader of a rock and roll band, it just wasn't around.
Yeah.
I mean, we had great performers like Tina Turner and Janis Joplin and Grace Slick, but the idea of frontal rock and roll performer, I don't know how it happened.
But let me ask you about
it. Not my fault.
No, it's great. But let me ask you about the gender stuff and as it plays into your practice in those days, right? I mean, you do Hey Joe and you disrupt it with 60 Days, the poem about Patty Hearst. You do Gloria, I mean, covering Van Morrison and Them at their most scruffy moment. You do My Generation, you're covering Townsend and that. You do Land of a Thousand Dances. I don't know whether you're covering the Chris Keener version or the Wilson Pickett version. But in any of these cases, you're covering things that are, you know, crotch-grinding guys with guitar. This is guys in front. And you play them as hard as they do, but you turn them inside out. Is that in play? Is the stance of gender in play in rock and roll? Or this is just stuff you did?
I really don't think about that stuff. I think why I'm not chained to the whole gender thing is because I started as an artist.
Yeah.
Since a child, I wanted to be an artist. I never attached gender to art, never attached gender to poetry. And I'm well aware that, you know, rock and roll has been traditionally a male game. And I just modeled myself after the best. I'm not saying that I was as good as them, but, you know, when I wanted to think about how to cut my hair, or how to look, or how to, you know, hold my guitar, I studied Jimi Hendrix. I studied Keith Richard. I studied Bob Dylan. I studied the people who I thought were, you know, truly, you know, who I identified with. And I never thought about it in terms of gender.
Let me talk about, or ask about, the other stream that enters into it. I mean, there's all of that rock stuff. But the cross, the hybrid here is Rambo and Verlaine. It's a gorgeous essay you wrote about Charleville, by the way.
Thank you.
Going back to visit Rambo's town. Indeed. And then, of course, the Beats. Were these influences coming at the same time? I mean, are you listening to the Stones at the same time you're reading A Season in Hell? Is this a grand stew? Or does one position you to appreciate the other?
I love rock and roll, and I love literature. I mean, when I was a kid, you know, I came from a relatively poor family. You know, there wasn't a whole lot to do for kids in a rural area in the early 60s, and the way that we expressed ourselves was through rock and roll.
Yeah.
And so I loved rock and roll, and as much as I loved Arthur Rimbaud, you know, they were both strong influences on me. The edge rock Arthur Rimbaud had was, I had such a crush on him, you know.
From the photo, that gorgeous photo?
But I had a crush, I mean, the thing
from the language?
Well, photo first, language second. I don't know. I don't know how to explain it. I don't like to really dissect myself.
Yeah.
I just am the way I am.
Oh, that's great.
And I don't really...
But it's such a heady brew. I mean, you know...
It's all from studying Peter Pan. You know, I mean, when I was a kid, I loved Wendy, but I wanted to be Peter.
Peter. Yeah.
You know, if I was watching Ramar the Jungle, I had to be Ramar. I had to be, you know... I like the leader.
Yeah.
You know, it's you know, I've played Flash Gordon, I'd have to be Flash, you know, whatever. And it's just you get in, you have a rock and roll band, you become the leader, and the leader is traditionally a male role, but it's not, and I don't say that with any sorrow or anger, you know, it just is, you know, your generals are usually male. You know, Lawrence of Arabia, you know, but it's just the role that I like.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I am a girl, you know.
Yeah.
I've always had a boyfriend, and I have kids, but as an artist, I don't feel like any particular gender.
Yeah.
And no, I'll never be boxed in terms of gender.
Apropos not being boxed in, when people think about what happens in the 70s and so forth, the referent tends to be 67, 68, you know, revolution in the street. But what your work makes so apparent is the role and the presence of the beats behind all of that, and the tendency to forget about Ginsberg or Kerouac or Corso in any of that. Can you talk a little bit about their importance for you?
Well, first of all, in the 60s, I mean, I was a schoolgirl, and then I was a book clerk. I wasn't really part of the revolution. I'm really a 70s person, yeah. Even though I'm young enough to be a 60s person, or old enough, I mean. how'd I say that? But I was just in the 60s, I didn't really have time for the revolution because I was always working, whether in a factory or, you know, so I pretty much spent my time studying and working. But I feel that the beautiful thing about the Beats, and when I think of them, even though, I mean, I was friends with them all.
Yeah.
I mean, luck is up, not Kerouac, but the one I have to say was the greatest influence is, well, he was my favorite, but is Allen Ginsberg.
Yeah.
Because Allen Ginsberg, more than anyone else, gave us the whole package. He was a free spirit. He pushed and pushed and pushed. He was a historian. He could, you know, speak to you about the link between William Blake and Walt Whitman and himself, and in the most esoteric or the clearest of terms. And he could also, when he was done, get out on the streets and motivate thousands of people to protest something the government was doing. That kind of force and energy we're really missing in a strong individual. Alan was like, he was like 10 people. And he was really like when Whitman says we contain multitudes, he was thinking about Allen Ginsberg, because he did.
You know, he was a member of our faculty.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm not surprised.
Yeah. Was, man, I was the assistant chair in those days, and Alan was teaching a course on the Beats. And I went by the seminar room we had up on 42nd Street, and he had finger cymbals on, and he had everybody in this room chanting. It was great. It was a fabulous moment. Apropos, though, this question of that power and being bored and such, when you enter into into rock and roll, it's at a tough time for rock and roll. I mean, it's kind of, I mean, it seemed anyway.
You mean in the early 70s?
Yeah, in the early, sort of 73, 74, 75, seemed to have spent its force. And people like you who brought back the ideas that had driven rock in the first place, did you feel that way? Did you feel that this was a kind of flat period?
Oh, yeah, I mean, I was definitely on a mission. I mean, it sounds conceited, but I don't mean it in a conceited
way. No, not a bit.
It was a rough time, because the people that we revered, I mean, one after another, we lost Jimi Hendrix, we lost Janis Joplin, we lost Jim Morrison, we had lost Brian Jones, Bob Dylan had a motorcycle accident and had withdrawn somewhat from the forefront of the public. Yep. And then it seemed like a new era was beginning of more glamorized rock and roll, more drugs, more you know, just glamour. And then the whole aspect of, you know, it's all sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Well, you know, all that's fun and everything, but there was also our revolutionary voice. There was also the thing that bound us all together, you know, in spiritually and emotionally and politically. And I felt that in danger.
Yeah.
I felt, and so I thought that I could maybe help a little.
Yeah.
I didn't really know what I was going to do, but I thought maybe I could stir up the real people.
Yeah.
You know, because I didn't think I was like a real person to be doing that, but I thought I could stir things up, and that's the idea of creating new space.
Yeah.
And you know, at the same time, people like Tom Verlaine and Richard Hell and all kinds of people were thinking the same.
You've said at the time you felt that the legacy of your generation was in jeopardy, right around the time that you're playing My Generation. I mean, how was it in jeopardy, and how did you imagine helping?
Well, I just felt that what we had was a cultural voice, and that cultural voice, you know, the hopes in the 60s, people like the MC5 and all of these very revolutionary bands, Jimi Hendrix, all of these people, what they were really wanted or what they were going for was a universal communication through rock and roll. And they felt that through rock and roll, as a universal language, we could change the world, because it would, you know, the idea of prejudice and so much corruption and corporatization would not be part of our ultimate language. Yeah. And with the death of so many of our leaders and also our political leaders, Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy, and it was just even Malcolm X. I mean, he also was a person with strong spiritual and political ideology. It just seemed that we were losing that. Even the radio was shifting in the 60s. Also, sorry to be talking like as if they're the good old days, because I don't mean it that way, but we didn't have cell phones, we didn't have fax machines, we didn't have most of us didn't have telephones or televisions. We didn't have credit cards. And so everything was, the radio was very, very important to us. It's how we got information. And our rock and roll stars gave us a lot of this information. When the Kent students were killed, four students killed by our own government and just innocently protesting the war, Neil Young's song Ohio galvanized us, because we all heard it, because everybody was listening to the radio. Everybody. We all listened to the same radio, the same songs, and were united.
Did you get Philly stations or New York stations or both where you were growing up?
Philly.
Philly, yeah.
But we had great stations.
So you had all that Wallace Ann stuff. And
well, we had
Jerry Blavitt. Yeah, the Gatorade hater.
Jerry Blavitt, this is a true story, right before the World Series, because, well, I was gunning for Philadelphia. Yeah. Sorry. But
Philly fans in the room.
I knew that New York, I mean, because I have a sixth sense about this, like I always win the Kentucky Derby. I knew New York was going to win, but I cheered for Philly anyway. Yeah. But anyway, I was sitting outside in an Italian restaurant, and this guy goes by in a Phillies cap, and he looks at me, and then he comes back, and it was Jerry Blavitt.
Damn it, amazing.
He was like my favorite DJ, him and Georgie Woods.
Georgie, of course.
Seeing a movie star. Yeah.
Like running into the Magmen on the street or something. God, fabulous.
But, you know, your question, it all sounds sort of naive, I guess, now. But back then, these were real fears and real concerns. And, I thought about this stuff day and night and what I could do. Sometimes I even wonder, how did I ever imagine that I could do anything? But I did. I was still working in a bookstore and playing with my friends. And we did what we could.
It's do what you could. You sign with Arista when Clive Davis is starting it. You've got John Cale and producing, and Horses appears. I mean, bam. I mean, for those of us who listened to that and felt the sense that rock and its promise and its capacity to unify, speak for, motivate a generation had been squandered, suddenly there's horses. I mean, it's just an extraordinary moment. Boom. I mean, you listen to Gloria and you start with, you know, that incredible, with Oath. And then we run. Would you mind if I just played a little of that? Or is that a bad idea?
Well, you can't imagine, you know, when you say all that. I mean, it's real flattering and it's really nice. And I like to hear it.
But let's
it also,
not.
No, it's okay. What I was going to say is, it's all I was hoping for. I was really, you know, you do these things when you're, you know, we didn't know. I mean, we had, you know, a few hundred people there, 500 people there. We had no idea what people were going to think, but that was our mission. Our mission was to let people know who felt like they were alone, who felt they were disenfranchised, who felt like, you know, nobody cared about them or nobody was talking about them. We wanted to know, our little band, we wanted to know that we were here for them.
Yeah.
And that's so nice.
I mean, it had for, you know, people all over. I mean, people talk about the first Velvet Underground album selling, you know, 1,400 copies, and everybody who heard it started a band. Horses had that. I mean, you felt that there was a manifesto, that something was alive.
Everybody wore a tie.
Well, well, that's Robert, right? I mean, but I won't play it. You're right. I mean, that's
no. I was just saying that I wasn't. I don't care if you play it or not. That wasn't my point. My point is that it just still amazes me that it people liked it, you know, that it's okay, that people respond to it. It's exciting, even though it was all, you know, it was like, what, 35 years ago or something? It's still exciting to know that.
Were you surprised that it had that kind of...
Yeah, I was happy.
Yeah, yeah.
Excited. It was exciting. The first time we heard Free Money on radio, me, Richard Soul, and Lenny were driving. We had a little job in Woodstock. And we heard Free Money on the radio. We were screaming. We were so excited. We had to put the car at the side of the road because we were so excited. Yeah, it's exciting.
Well, it was exciting to hear it. I had to pull my car over as well. All right.
Oh, geez.
The people's choice. Of course, you realize that my saying I'm going to play it is dependent upon my being able to work this thing, which is a big upset.
What is that thing?
It's an ancient iPod that my daughter bought for me. Well, we'll get there. Just give me a minute.
Yeah, my kids get me all my technology, too.
And then they make it work. Well, we're slowly getting there. Or maybe, there we go. All right. Now, if this actually works, it's going to be a huge upset. We may put to rest the whole question of whether we should do this. it doesn't seem to be. So. Nah, we'll play it later. Is John here?
Yes.
Anyway, wait, here we... Oops, this is the wrong thing, but...
This is some other person.
Yes, some other person. But it was a powerful impact, that other person. It worked the other night.
Oh, I'll just play them something. They don't, you know.
There we go. We got it. Wait, here we are. All right. Oh, wait, this is the Morrison one. God damn it. All right. We're getting closer all the time. We're getting closer.
That sounded like me.
Yeah, that was you.
What? This is unbelievable.
Yep, it is.
See, we didn't have any of this stuff to screw up.
Only 15 minutes in the making.
Nah, that wasn't so bad.
Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine. Milner, pot thieves, wild cord on my sleeve, thick heart of stone, my sins my own, they belong to me, me. People say beware, but I don't care. The words are just rules and regulations to me, me.
Time to pull a car over.
Well, anything's allowed. I go this here party. I just get bored. I'm sure you got the wind to see the young fun. Hopping on the parking meter, leaning on the parking meter.
That Patti wasn't the only person who pulled the car over on the side of the road.
I never heard it on an iPod.
Well, there you go.
It doesn't sound so bad.
Only 15 minutes in the making, pretty damn impressive. The anthem quality to it is one thing. The joy is another. I mean, when the next CD, Radio Ethiopia, that you do with Jack Douglas. Douglas tells the story about the worst hurricane in memory. And he lives in Metuchen, I think. And you call him on the phone. I don't know whether it's apocryphal or not.
His version is true.
He picks up the phone. They've got, you know, plywood on the windows. The police have closed the road. And you're saying, it's tonight. And you've got to come. You're Electric
Lady. We were at Record Plant. Which is where Jimi Hendrix recorded. He did a lot of recording there. And Record Plant was a great studio. But we were doing this record, Radio Ethiopia. And Radio Ethiopia was going to be the title track, totally improvised. And I had to get myself ready for it, study in Rumbo and Brancusi and Ethiopia.
Sacred ground and all for Rumbo.
And all of this stuff and all of a sudden it was August 9th and there was a full moon or something. I decided and the winds were, there was a strange light because there was a hurricane coming.
Yeah.
But good old Jack Douglas, he came and we did. I mean, it was hell out there, but we did it, and it was a great night.
It's a great record. And that you say, I mean, again, it's just a great quote. You say, as you're making this thing, and the hurricane's outside, and Douglas has got things under the door, so the wind. You say, it was just me on my knees, laughing, hysterically thankful for the privilege of playing in a rock and roll band. And that sense of joy and the ecstatic, whether we think about it in terms of romantic poetry, or we think about it, Ginsberg doing Howl, or we think about what rock and roll can do, all present in your performance.
I mean, I was a girl who, I felt rock and roll saved me. I was skinny. I had really tall, really skinny, sort of with really bad skin. I just, I had a million tons of energy. Yeah. I didn't know, where I belonged. And I felt like rock and roll, like, saved my life. Well, it gave me something to identify with.
It's like Sweet Jane, right?
And finally, to have a rock and roll band, I've never taken it for granted. Yeah. I don't ever take it for granted. Every night or anywhere we do a concert, whether it's for 50,000 people or 500 people, I'm like, we have a little moment, the band. And Lenny Kaye is the same. I've been playing with Lenny now since 1970, and he is the exact same way. Every single concert, we just, without words, just say a little prayer, just of gratitude to be in a rock and roll band. It's sure. Like, at least from, from where we come from, it's a privilege.
But so true in that time. I mean, Sweet Jane's life is saved by rock and roll. I mean, there is that sense of listening to the radio, say, nothing's going down at all, is the line from that song, and suddenly your life is saved.
Or Jimi Hendrix, nothing was happening at all.
But you talk about 500 versus, 50,000 or whatever. I mean, the band becomes extremely successful. After Wave, you do a European tour. You got 70,000 people showing up in Florence. Was it the same thing? I mean, to push on what you just said, when you play at CBGB's or the Mud Club or Max's, and you know the people, and there's a kind of community that's involved, what happens when you take it to giant venues and you've got this huge throng present to hear you play?
It's really the same. It's all about communication. It depends on the kind of performer you are. So I'm a channeling type of performer, so the amount of people, I don't get scared. I don't get stage fright or anything like that. So I just get up there, and then it's an expanse. It's like a canvas. If the canvas is very small, then you're projecting here. But if it's big, if there's like at the Fuji Festival, maybe there's 60,000 people, you just project out to the furthest person and just almost like create a thing. You let them know, all right, here is the expanse that I'm projecting to. It's like everybody from here and the people in the wings all the way in the back, and then we create the night together. So it's really about mutual communication. Because a performer, I know at least myself, and it's not even an age-related thing, it's sometimes humidity-related. You have high humidity, trying to sing in high humidity is really hard, pushing the air. And I've had nights where I just like literally had to say, help me, send me some energy, because I'm like on a treadmill. And the people, they'll send it to you, and then you give it back to them. It's a possibility in performance. Not all performers. Some people are entertainers, or they're more theatrical, so they have a show that they present. There's nothing wrong with that. That's how some people work. But we don't work like that. We don't have any sound cues. We don't have our own lights. We don't have loops. We don't have in-ears. We're just the same. We're just like an. Yeah. We don't play or work any different than we did in CBGB's. Yeah. And we still don't. I don't care if I play a stadium or in a club. We work the same and pretty much have the same equipment.
Is that helped by playing with people for such a long time. I mean, Lenny forever, but the rest of the band you've worked with for a very long time as well. Does that collaboration play into?
Well, yeah, I mean, because they understand. Yeah. You know, they understand that. But a lot of people, I have the same. I was just at Ornette Coleman's Meltdown, and performed with the Masters of Jujuka, performed with Ornette, performed with Flea. And, you know, it's music. We all, like, we're speaking the same language. Well, we're there for the same thing.
Let me push the collaborative thing a bit. I mean, painters, visual artists in general, romantic poets. I mean, the notion of the collaborative is not the first thing that comes to mind. But your career has been marked by extraordinarily productive collaboration. I mean, in some ways, starting with Mapplethorpe. And you've got a new book coming out in January about that time. Can you talk a little bit about the collaborative process with him, with others in your life, how you've managed to find that mutually productive ground?
Well, a beautiful thing about working with Robert is we collaborated in two ways. One, in a very hands-on way, where we both would work on a drawing, later in doing photographs with each other. But our best way of collaborating was working side by side, just believing in each other. Yeah. So our collaboration was more about trust than actually working on something. Mm. And that's sort of the schism about being involved in rock and roll. And because I still think of myself as an artist, and which is there's so much solitude attached to being an artist. I do my drawings by myself, I take my photographs by myself, I write my poems. It requires solitude. It's self-generated. Mm. And then rock and roll is entirely collaborative.
Yeah.
It's not just your band, and I have a really great supportive band, but it's your crew. Mm. Your every person, you know, the person that gets you coffee, the person who's doing your sound, the guys, all these guys that you never even know their name, who are, you know, plugging in a million cables. Yes. You know, we all make the show, and the people, you know, it's a huge collaboration.
How did the collaboration work with your husband? I mean, you talk about his giving you themes or ideas or assignments from which you would develop lyrics. Was that about trust and working side by side, or was it a more...
Well, Fred was really a great artist.
Great guitar player.
He was,
among other
he was not the easiest man to work with. Yeah. And he was my husband, which makes it even sometimes more difficult. But I had such respect for him. And I just did everything I could to comprehend what he was looking for and to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, our greatest work we did together was creating our children.
Yeah.
But when we did a song like People of the Power, Fred literally, he came in, I remember it very clearly, I was peeling potatoes, and I was over the sink peeling potatoes, and he says, "Trisha." And I said, "What?" And he said, "People of the Power, write it." "Yes, sir." as soon as I finished KP duty. So, and we were very interested at that time. It was in the like 85 or 86, and we were watching Jesse Jackson's campaign. And so I really meditated on this phrase, "People of the Power." And I went back to, I read a lot of the Bible, the area where it speaks of the meek shall inherit the earth. I just thought of all the different ways that how the people, we need the people to access their power, to stop, you know, protest against war, against the destruction of our environment. And so I took all of these ideas and wrote him the lyrics and gave them to him, and he wrote the song.
Is this during the time when he was teaching you to play acoustic?
No, Fred taught me to play at the end of his life. In 94, because he was quite ill, and it was a way that he could center himself and do something. He was also giving me a gift. He was giving me the ability to write my own songs, because I had spent the last 16 years writing with him, even many, many songs that we never recorded. And so it was his last gift to me, actually, to teach me enough chords to write songs. And the first song I wrote after he passed away was Farewell Reel. For him. So it's my first use of the lessons he gave me.
A series of dreadful losses. I mean, Fred, your brother Todd, Robert, Richard Soule. How did that experience, the elegiac has always been a part of your work. I mean, the sense of memoir, souvenir, photographs of tombstones and such a powerful thread in your life. How did you come to terms with all of that loss and turn it into art?
Well, you don't turn it all into art. I think a lot of it you turn into becoming a better person, because all the people that I lost, well, I lost many, but specifically these four men in rapid succession, all under 45, each one of them had such fine qualities and taught me so much about myself that I tried to, in losing them, deeply focus on the gifts they gave me and magnify them. My brother was unconditional love. Robert was his belief in me as an artist. Each one gave me something. And so instead of just making that a part of who they were, it became the bigger part, because I had lost their physical presence. And I think that in time, as I process the loss of them, each one gave me something special. Yeah. And it sounds sort of rhetorical or something, but it's actually true.
Yeah, no, it didn't seem rhetorical.
Just like with my parents and losing my mom, we had, as usual, our problems, and I didn't always appreciate her. But in losing her, all of her beautiful qualities became magnified, and I'm still learning from her. Yeah. I think it's also what we focus on when we lose people. Some people, if you focus on the negative aspects or all the bad things or, the fights you had or the injustices, especially with a husband and wife, you can have a lot of things, that you can mull over. That's what you'll wind up with. We all know that these things happened, but if you really focus on make the lion's share the better part, it'll serve you much better. It seems like me and my mom are closer than ever.
That's a beautiful thing.
Thanks.
You're at a different stage of career now. A senior figure in all that is rock and roll and what we've done. You were talking before about the mission. It's to give your energy and to accept the energy of an audience. You've said that we all have a voice. We have the responsibility to exercise it, to use it. Have you imagined that the way in which you exercise your voice has changed, or is it still the same desire to speak that was present that, in Horses and when you were first playing in the East Village?
Well, when one evolves, I wrote a lot of the words for Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine. I writ when I was 20, and in the last 43 years, I've gone through, you know, intense amount of evolution, hopefully. And I can't be that person. I'm not filled with adolescent energy. I'm more filled with 11-year-old energy. But I don't know. Yeah. I think if anything, being a mom, I think has informed my work or the way that I look at things. I still can be disinterested and self-centered, as a lot of artists are, but still, being a mother, you can't help but become more empathetic and compassionate. And I think the biggest change in me is, when I was young, I was talking to the disenfranchised, who I imagined would be just artists and poets and activists. And now I look at the disenfranchised as a different class of people. We're all disenfranchised. You know, I look at, you know, what's happened to America. I look at the economic strife in Detroit, where I lived for 16 years. I look at, you know, how, you know, the people are, you know, lied to and used. And so the disenfranchised, who I wind up wanting to reach out to, isn't just, you know, I think it's a wider range of people. I've learned that, you know, the my world isn't centered around artists and poets.
But do you still believe the people have the power?
I'll always believe that. I think that they don't know that. I don't think that they believe that. And I understand why they don't believe that, because it's getting harder and harder and harder to penetrate, you know, the walls that are built, the corporate walls. I mean, the Bush administration built such impenetrable walls that, you know, Obama is just, it's like he's chipping away with an ice pick, you know. And it's really difficult. And it's hard, you know, it's hard to keep heart and keep protesting and keep, you know, using your voice. But we have to do that. Ralph Nader taught me a long time ago that we have to not be ready to win when we go out and protest against our government or protest war or protest Con Edison or whoever else needs to be protested against. We have to be willing to lose and lose and lose and lose and lose, but still make certain that we are counted, that the opposition or the people who are oppressing us know that we exist, and to be a thorn in their side and keep poking and poking and poking and poking till finally they bleed. And that's, it seems, all
we can do. Is that the course of freedom redefined?
I don't know. I read it.
It's your line, man.
It's a good line. I only read it. It's. I didn't define it. You know, it means many things. If I redefined it, it would be, you know, it's to be redefined simultaneously in several different ways.
I mean, early on, you know, covering the Who, and, you know, hope we die before we get old. Well, we didn't. We're here. What's the legacy of my generation? I mean, you say we had dreams, and then you know, we created George Bush was your line. How would you retrospectively think about it, or is that impossible to think about?
What, my generation?
The legacy of my generation, right.
Well, we're still here. I mean, I'm only 63. I'm not 140. You know, it's just like, we're not done yet. So
far from it. That's a legacy. That's sufficient. Will you favor us with a song or two?
Sure.
How can I?
Hi.
Get this here.
He's a good roadie, by the way.
Just can't work an iPod. Other than that, it's a dandy thing. this down. We're going to get John here to help us with the microphones. My pleasure.
So thanks for coming out, and of course, we'll all probably miss House, but I have a crush on Hugh Laurie, too. I'll see how this... So this little song is called Grateful, and I wrote this when Jerry Garcia died, and it's dedicated to him, hence the title. It's not really about Jerry. It has Jerry in it. It has Jerry's silver hair in it. So it's the silver thread in the song. So.
Just another skin simply slips away. You can rise above it. It will shed easily. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One coming wire, one silver thread, all that you desire grows on ahead. Like a ship in a bottle, held up to the sun, sails ain't going nowhere. Count everyone until it crashes onto the earth, simply slips away. You can hide in the open, I just disappear. It all will come out fine. I've learned it like by light, one coming wire, one silver thread, all that you desire grows on ahead. Ours is just a craving and a twist of the wrist. We'll undo the stopper with abrupt tenderness. Die, little sparrow, and awake singing. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One coming wire, one silver thread, all that you desire grows on ahead. Thank you.
you. Thank you. So, obviously, I only learned so much from Fred. But, in fact, he said, Trisha, after going on for months trying to teach me a handful of chords, don't ever tell anybody who taught you. So I thought that I would recite the words to the song that Fred and I wrote together. And I always like to remind people that the words "people of the power" were Fred's. So, I was dreaming in my dreaming of an aspect bright and fair, and my sleeping, it was broken, but my dream, it lingered near, in the form of shining valleys where the pure air rarefied, and my senses newly opened when I awakened to the cry that the people have the power to redeem the work of fools. Upon the meek the graces shower. It's decreed the people rule, and vengeful aspects became suspect and bending low as if to hear, and the armies ceased advancing because the people had their ear, and the shepherds and the soldiers lay beneath the stars, exchanging visions, laying arms to waste in the dust for the people of the power, the people of the power. And where there were deserts, I saw fountains, and like cream the waters rise, and we strolled there together with none to laugh or criticize, and the leopard and the lamb lay together, truly bound. I was hoping, in my hoping, to recall what I had found. I was dreaming in my dreaming. God knows a purer view. But as I surrender to my sleeping, I commit my dream to you, that the people have the power to redeem the world of fools. Upon the meek the graces shower. It's decreed the people rule. And I believe that everything we dream will come to pass through our union. We can turn the world around. We can turn the earth's revolution. For the people have the power. The people have the power. The people have the power. I was so disposed toward a mission yet unclear, advancing pole by pole. Fortune breathed into my ear, obey the simple code. One road was paved in gold. One road was just a road. Whoa, sorry, I wigged out. In my blinking year, such a woeful schism, the pain in our existence was not as I envisioned. That tramp from track to track, worn down to the soul. One road was paved in gold. One road was just a road. Am I blinking? Yeah.
politician. Yeah, that hiss. Just a shallow spear. Rude and cowardice. Brace yourself for bitter flack. For a life divine. A labyrinth of riches never shall unwind. The tears that bind the pilgrim sack are stitched into the Blakeyan back. So throw off your stupid cloak. Embrace all that you fear. 'Cause joy will conquer all despair in my Blakeyan year. So throw off your stupid cloak. Embrace all that you fear. 'Cause joy will conquer all despair in my Blakeyan year. In my Blakeyan year. In my Blakeyan year.
Thank you. What?
That was wonderful.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us. Again, our profound thanks to Miss Patti Smith.
Thank you. I had a really good time. Thank you. Take care of yourself. Drink a lot of water. And if you have extra money, let me just give you a tip. Get your teeth professionally cleaned 4 times a year. If not, at least 2. And you'll save yourself a lot of heartache down the road.
I do. I do. My dear.